for the players, it's an annual rite of passage for these fans. Well, they might just get to see the next great Mountaineers. The Gold Blue Spring Game comes your way this afternoon from Mylan Pushkar Stadium in Morgantown, West Virginia. Hi, friends. Welcome inside the stadium. Nick Farrell here, thrilled to be alongside Rasheed Marshall. Amanda Mazie is the third member of our crew for today's spring game. Rasheed, a new group of Mountaineers, but the message to them is about the same as it always is around this time of year. One last chance to really make an impression before the fall.
That's exactly right. And I think it's important for people to truly know and understand what this last practice and game is all about. For these young freshmen, this is their first opportunity in a game day-like setting here at Mylan Pushkar Stadium. For some of the guys that's 2 and 3 on a depth chart, they get to make their lasting impressions for the final evaluations to truly push up that depth chart for playing time.
We'll be keeping an eye on all of those guys today, and we know that you folks at home are likely keeping an eye on those quarterbacks, right? Garrett Green and Nico Markiel, but let's get one thing straight. A decision on next year's starting quarterback is not going to be made after today's spring game. It's a competition that's going to wage into the fall, but Rasheed, the coaching staff really seems to be pleased with the progression of both Green and Markiel this spring.
Both of these guys have done a great job all spring. I know I came along board a little bit through the spring, but both guys have done a great job and fully capable.
Garrett Green played in 9 games last season, started the final 2, but it was really that relief performance against Oklahoma. He showed what he was made of, leading the Mountaineers to their first victory over the Sooners since the 2008 Fiesta Bowl. Didn't see as much of Markiel last season, 3 games played, but he did help the Mountaineers salt away a victory in Stillwater against Oklahoma State in the season finale. The fans are here. Head coach Neil Brown is here. We'll get ready to rock and roll at the Gold Blue Game next on Big 12 Now on ESPN+. They've brought on the Mountaineers here at Mylan Pushkar Stadium for the annual Gold Blue Spring Game. The gold team will be the offensive team, the blue team, the defense. And here's how scoring will work. Yes, the defense can score points. There will be a bunch of one-on-one competitions. Players can earn points for their respective teams. But first, let's send it down now to the third member of our team. She's Amanda Mazie, and she's standing by with head coach Neil Brown. What's going on, Amanda?
First quarter with your guys hitting the field.
I want everybody to stay healthy first and foremost. I want the guys to have fun. I want the people that are braving the weather to really enjoy it. I want it to be a good experience for our recruits here. We got several recruits that are our high-end guys that'll hopefully will be signing with us in December. And so I want to see good, clean football. We've got a Big 12 officiating crew, and this is for our players. You know, we're going to evaluate it, but today's for our players.
What would you like to see specifically out of the quarterback competition between Nico and Garrett?
Yeah, clean football, and I want to see them operate. Accuracy, that's something that we're always talking about. We want them to throw the ball down the field today, and hopefully we'll hit some shots. And then decision-making. That's how, at the end of the day, accuracy and decision-making is how we're going to make this decision.
Defensively, on the other side of the ball, what are you looking for?
Tackle. You know, we need to tackle. And that was an issue for us last year. And so I want to make sure we're getting 11 hats to the ball, and then we're a better tackling team than we finished last year.
All right, we'll check in with you before halftime. Thanks, Coach. Appreciate your time. Nick?
All right, Amanda and Coach, thanks very much. Okay, so action is about to begin, and in fact, we're taking a look now at the kickoff challenge that's going on the field. The two kickers, by the way, to keep an eye on are Michael Hayes and Danny King. Hayes, a transfer from Georgia State. King, a redshirt junior on the Mountaineers roster. We mentioned the scoring. Touchdown, 6 points as usual. Field goals, 3. The score is 7-4. Gold 7, blue 4. Why? Well, you're looking at it. Rasheed, what exactly are we looking at here?
Listen, the offense can think Grayson Malachevich, the fur coat, no shirt underneath, had the burgundy slacks to go with it. I mean, the guy stole the show, honestly.
So there was a fashion show before the spring game today, and that's why points were awarded, right?
That's exactly right. So each guy had the opportunity to put on their best threads, to put on the best drip, as they call it. Come through the door, you get your picture taken, and myself, alongside Tony Caridi, a few guys from over at Daniels, we sat around, we judged, and Grayson was the guy.
So you're telling me that fine-looking Phil part of this, that he gave the green light to Grayson?
He gave the green light to Grayson. I don't think there was any other guy that came close, honestly.
I mean, that is swaggy. I mean, I couldn't pull that off, that's for sure. So, 7-4 is your score. Gold with 7. Again, that's the offensive team. Blue with 4, that's the defensive team. A couple more things to keep an eye out for. Defensive team can score on a 3-and-out. That's 7 points for the defense. A defensive turnover will automatically gain the defense 7 points as well, or any defensive stop other than a 3-and-out or a turnover is the equivalent of a field goal, 3 points for the defense. So that's how the D will be able to stay competitive in this spring game. And also XFL style conversions too, that adds a little extra wrinkle. Again, if you go for a point after from the 2, that's 1 point. From the 5, that's 2 points. From the 10, that's a 3-point conversion. So for any of you who don't follow the XFL, that's a breakdown of what you could be looking for today if the scoring is tight down the stretch.
Yeah, unique set of scoring right there. And I actually like that because it makes you think a little bit in terms of, hey, do you have confidence in your kicker? Will he nail it? If not, if it's a close game, you're going to find yourself kind of backed up into a situation and having to make a decision.
A lot of unique wrinkles in this game. We mentioned the quarterbacks at the top of the broadcast, Garrett Green and Nico Markiel. They'll likely rep with the ones throughout the first half. First and second quarter will be 10 minutes of normal clock. The ones in the first quarter, ones and twos in the second. Then into the third and fourth quarter, twos and threes will split that time. Likely that the second half, third and fourth quarter, will operate on a 10-minute running clock. Okay, getting ready for the scrimmage portion of the spring game to begin. Again, the gold team is the offensive unit, the blue team, the defense, and it's a 3-point gold lead because Grayson Malashevitz showed up in a fur coat with nothing on underneath. I mean, I just don't know that you could ever find a more unique way to start a spring game than that. So here we go with Garrett Green. The quarterback's wearing white jerseys, by the way. Garrett Green getting the start here in the spring game from the 30-yard line with 2 running backs in his backfield and 2 wide receivers to his right. And the give is to C.J. Donaldson, the former tight end from Miami, Florida, who had a standout freshman season before an injury ended the front portion of that season.
Yeah, good job up front by the offensive line. I think this is one of the strengths that West Virginia will truly go to. The strongest room in the building is definitely the running back, so putting 2 guys out there to begin the game, that's perfect.
4 running backs recorded multiple touches last season. All 4 of those running backs back this year. C.J. Donaldson, Tony Mathis, Justin Johnson, and Jalen Anderson. It's Donaldson. No, it's not. It's Green who keeps over the middle. Jumping catch by Jeremiah Aaron for a first down past midfield for the gold team. Hey, we're going to see a lot of play action, a lot of read options this year, aren't we, Rasheed?
That's exactly right. So if you can get that running game going and suck those linebackers in on the second level, try to open up some throwing lanes, that's going to be, you know, something that West Virginia can truly count on. So you got to get the running game going first, but great grab right there by Jeremiah Aaron.
So another first down here for the gold team, which now leads 9-4 after the kicking competition to begin the spring game. Donaldson in the backfield with Green. Little sweep action to Aaron to the far side. Brought down for no gain. Lee Koba and Jared Bartlett in the vicinity. So here's a look at the schedule of events for the spring game. We've got a ton going on between the scrimmage and some individual competitions today. We already saw the kickoff challenge. There will be some red zone 1v1s between the wide receivers and defensive backs. Pass protection and pass rush competitions as well. A punting competition to begin the second half, as well as a field goal challenge. And on a lot of these, it's not just going to be players, but some fans will get involved as well. So we're looking forward to seeing that. Second and 10 from the 45. The give is to Donaldson once again for a gain of about 4. C.J. Donaldson, all Big 12 honorable mention last season. Wasn't sure how much we'd get to see of him this spring since he's coming off that injury, but he's been a full participant most of the way.
Yeah, and he's a load. Listen, at 6'2", 240 pounds as a defensive back, as that game plays on, you're not going to want to tackle him. He's a load, but had a fabulous spring. The guy comes to work every single day. I tip my hat to him.
Third and six for Garrett Green and the Gold offense. Green working out of the shotgun for each snap through this opening possession. He's got Donaldson to his right, three receivers on the near side, and he's coming that way. Green going to keep it, and they'll spot him at the 40-yard line. Remember, minimal contact on these quarterbacks here during the spring game. That's not enough for a first down. It'll be fourth and five.
Yeah, and this is one of the things that Garrett Green does extremely well. We all know once he gets outside of the pocket, he's an absolute weapon with his legs. So that's one thing that he can bring to this offense, and it's an extra added element to his game.
Neil Brown says big play ability. We know that, but what Coach Brown means, sometimes he can make negative big plays. One thing that's going to be important for Green throughout this competition process that's going to wage on into the fall is decision making. Clock ticking below 6.5 minutes here in the opening quarter of the spring game. Gold team going to go for it on fourth and five. This time a full reverse pass from Preston Fox to Garrett Green. How about that to the 10-5? Touchdown, Garrett Green.
A little Philly special. The Philly special. Listen, you can never go wrong. We'll get another look here on the replay, but they showed the reverse early. Jeremiah Aaron kept it right there. Preston Fox showing off that extremely precious arm of his. He's a very good athlete, and there's no doubt in my mind they're going to try to use him as many ways as possible. But
hey, that's a great grab by Garrett Green there.
Great toss, great grab.
Preston Fox loves the Gold Blue game. He had a breakout performance last year in the spring scrimmage. 5 receptions for 117 yards. And he gets a touchdown pass to Garrett Green this time around. So the Gold team leads the Blue team after the point after 16-4 with 6 minutes, 14 seconds to go in the first quarter. Neil Brown said he maybe would be, you know, reserving the playbook for future games. It's a little bit of trickery, a little bit of fun for the spring game. You never know what you're going to see.
It is. Listen, in this spring, he just told us, listen, this is for the guys. This is for the players. They've worked hard all spring. Let's try to reward them. Yes, we want to see them make strides. We want to see them put a good product on tape to close out the spring. But listen, let's make it about the players.
Hey, one thing that is interesting is that with new offensive coordinator Chad Scott, this is one of his first opportunities to call plays in a scrimmage situation. The team has been scrimmaging throughout the spring on Saturdays. He and quarterbacks coach Sean Reagan are sharing the offensive play calling responsibilities today. On defense, plays called by defensive backs coach Shadon Brown and special teams coordinator and inside linebackers coach Jeff Coombs. There is Scott, the fifth-year assistant. He'll remain in charge of the running backs room for West Virginia this season, that veteran group, as well as serve as the offensive coordinator this season. Okay, back to action here. Nico Markiel now at quarterback. Drive begins from the 30-yard line in the first quarter with the offensive Gold team leading 16-4. Markiel, quick pass on the near side to Jarrell Williams, who breaks a tackle and gains about 5, maybe 6 yards to set up a second and medium. Montre Miller with the tackle.
So that's one thing that, you know, the defensive coaches, they want to try to see is better tackling. That was 23, Keyshawn Cobb in the open field, had an opportunity. But for Nico, this is an opportunity for him to get great experience, game time type of reps. Like I mentioned, this is live in the arena, and this is what truly makes a difference once the fall rolls around, because you can shake off those jitters early and get used to this atmosphere.
Give is to Jalen Anderson going to the far side. Brought down in the backfield for a loss. Tyreek Austin Cave, the transfer from Miami, making the stop.
Yeah. Offensive line doing a good job trying to get some zone blocking up front, but that was good pursuit right there by the defensive line, and that's Tyreek Austin Cave. He's a linebacker for the WVU defense. Pretty stout player. I like him a lot. Very physical player, and he understands what's happening. He's a guy that can get people lined up, and they respect him on his team as well.
Austin Cave, 9 games played last season in his first year with the Mountaineers, had a tackle against Virginia Tech. One of those guys that you could look to on offense or on defense that maybe is going to take a step forward between year one and year two for the Mountaineers. Here's a 3rd and 6 for Markiel in the offense. Flips it forward, might have been deflected. And I think we're going to get a spot for a sack on Markiel. Good pressure by the defensive line.
Yeah, that was number 55, Hawkins. Big Day-Day, they call him. Day-Day Hawkins. Davion. But Right here, Nico will learn you have to get that ball out quick. You don't have as much time, and that's one thing in the spring as a quarterback. Sometimes you get that clock in your head and you lose track because you're a non-contact type of player. But with this true game atmosphere, again, you get to feel that clock, that mental clock going off in your mind.
Take a look at Dante Stills back at Milan Pushkar Stadium as he pursues his pro ambitions. He's an honorary head coach of the defensive team today on the other sideline with the gold team. Bryce Ford Wheaton is the other honorary head coach. Both of those guys, NFL draft hopefuls, coming up here in just about a week. Could be a life-changing day for one or both of them.
That's right. Extremely exciting period in time for both of those guys. I mean, I think they've been doing a lot of hard working and, you know, working out with Coach Joseph. So I've seen them around the building. Wish the best of luck to them.
Give to Tony Mathis on a fresh set of downs for the gold team. By the way, a three and out there for the blue team. And remember, that's good for 7 points, the equivalent of a defensive touchdown in this spring game. So that's why the score changed to 16-11.
Yeah, we talk about backs. That's Tony Mathis, another one of these running backs for WVU. And you want to try to get north and south. You put that ball, that foot in the ground, and just try to get that ball north and south as fast as possible.
Second and medium coming here. Stop made on that last play by Trey Lathan, the redshirt freshman linebacker from Florida. This time, Markiel pulls it, looking for options on the near side, and flips it to the tight end, Cole Taylor, who has enough for a first down for the gold team just beyond the 45-yard line.
Good job by Markiel right here. He's outside of the pocket. And I think a lot of people, they have the misconception that he's not so much a runner. He can get outside of the pocket and make plays with his legs, but that was good job being patient with the football, sucking that defense up to him, and at the last second, going ahead and dropping it off the tight end, Cole.
Markiel, 3 games played last season, 6 rushes for 32 yards. That's the first reception of the spring game for the LSU transfer, Cole Taylor, a guy the coaching staff is thrilled about. The 6'7 junior could be a real threat for the Mountaineers in the red zone come the fall. First and 10, give to Tony Mathis, the veteran back. Good cut by Mathis. Enough for a first down to the 43, maybe the 42.
You know, it's so impressive just getting to watch these guys every single day and understanding how big they are, but they're so fast and so quick and so shifty. You know, I credit again Mike Joseph for getting these guys in peak physical condition, but Tony Mathis is another guy who's going to really be able to help this offense this fall.
Both Mathis and Justin Johnson are 2-year letter winners in the running back room. Mathis led the team in rushing yards last season, 562 total yards, good for about 4 per carry, and he had 5 touchdowns. Under 3 minutes left in the first quarter, first and 10 from the 42 for the offense. Another give to Mathis, good pop to gain about 6 yards to the 36. Tackle made again by Day-Day Hawkins, the Tennessee State transfer who's been active in this first quarter.
That's right. Davion Hawkins, he's a veteran player first, but he has really good pursuit. And again, another good run right there by Mathis. One thing that you won't see a lot of, he's not going to get stopped behind the line of scrimmage. He's trying to get north and south, has great vision, great patience, but once he gets that foot in the ground, he's going to turn it up.
On the offensive line, no Zach Frazier. He's missed most of the spring with an injury, so it's Brandon Yates handling the center duties. Second and 5 from the 37. Under 2 minutes left in the first quarter. Quick pass from Markiel. Tried to get the screen to Devin Carter. First target for the NC State transfer falls incomplete. So it's 3rd and 5 with 1:48 left.
Yep, Devin D.C. Carter. He's a physical specimen at wide receiver. And, you know, I told a few of my former teammates that he reminds me so much of Chris Henry, a bigger, thicker Chris Henry. They both wear number 5. They both rock the dreads, but he's a physical specimen and, again, going to be able to help this offense out a lot. Veteran player, as you mentioned, Nick, transfer from NC State.
49 games played with the Wolfpack, nearly 2,000 career receiving yards and more than 100 receptions. 3rd and 5 from the 37. Markiel in the shotgun with a running back to his right. It's Donaldson. Markiel is sacked, and in the vicinity was Mike Lockhart, the big defensive tackle, 6'3", 309.
Yeah, give the defense a lot of credit right there. That was a covered sack, so nowhere to go with the football for Markiel. You can see him working through his progressions. First, second, third window, everything was taken. He had to do his best as he could to get back to the line of scrimmage.
So a defensive stop is good for 3 points for the blue team. We'll get a score update for you in a moment. Let's go into our sideline reporter, Amanda Massey. What's up, Amanda?
All right, I found this guy, the legendary Daryl Talley, joining us now. You look surprised by this.
I am. I'm surprised I'm here.
What does it mean to you to still be a part of this program? I know that you talked to the team earlier this week. You're here in the sideline. You were just talking to Garrett Green. How cool is that for you to still be so close to this program?
Well, it gives me a lot of pleasure to know that I can still relay some information to guys that may help them. I can tell them from my experience and strength and what I've done and what I haven't. And I can tell them what everybody's looking at at the next level. So if I can help, I would like to help.
Absolutely. And I see you're into the game. You're like, that's a big hole. Do that. I mean, you're still very much into this, aren't you?
I like football. That's what I enjoy doing. That's what I did for my life. Just something that I really, really am passionate about.
Well, the guys had their fit check before the game. You have a good fit check, too. So, Daryl, thank you so much for joining us, and we'll look forward to seeing you around the program.
All right. Thank you. I look forward to being here. And my fit worked.
Fit works. Nick, I'm telling you, it's all about the fit these days with the young guys and the older guys. Not old, older.
I'm older.
No.
I'm old.
Thanks, Daryl. Nick.
Oh, my goodness. That's terrific stuff, Amanda. Well, you know, Daryl Talley was in town earlier this week to speak to the players as they wrapped up their spring practices. And what a tremendous message, Rashid. He said, when you play at Mylan Pushkar Stadium on Saturdays, you're not just playing for yourself and your teammates. You're playing for all of us, the brotherhood of Mountaineer football.
That's exactly right. I mean, there's decades and eras going back of players who kind of paved the way for the new school guys to come through. And that's one thing I always understood as a player. There's guys that came before me that did the work that allowed me to be in the position I was in. And that's the same message he tried to relay.
Who was that guy for you?
The guy for me was Solomon Page, Major Harris, a lot of guys from my high school, Mike Booth, Corey Ivey. I can go on, the list is long. Avon Coburn, those guys, they showed me how to work as a young player, and you know, it paid off.
Daryl Talley's number 90 was retired 2 seasons ago. So was the iconic number 9 of the Mage, Major Harris. Green breaking free. Somebody got there close enough to him to whistle the play dead. Think it was Jai Favoris and Ben Cutter involved. Garrett Shifty, we know that. That's the end of the first quarter. The gold team, the offense, leading the blue team 16-14. We're having fun during the Gold Blue spring game. We're getting after it here on Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus. So glad you're with us. Looking live at WVU Medicine Children's Hospital, which of course has an important place in the Gold Blue spring game at Mylan Pushkar Stadium. Since 1984, a partnership founded by then head coach Don Nealon, the football program has raised nearly $800,000 for the beautiful new Children's Hospital. And Rashid, I don't know if you've been up there, but to see the view of the stadium on a game day or not from the Hostetler Family Resource Center on the top floor of that hospital is absolutely breathtaking.
I have. It is something special. And you know, you mentioned how far back this goes, starting with Coach Nealon, but, you know, it's something for me that I truly enjoy doing. I get back. I love to do community service. You know, without the fans, without us being able to help the people who give us the energy and gave me the energy to come out here and perform on Saturday, it's one way to be able to give back to them.
But we've got a little bit of one-on-one action going on, and that is an INT by Malachi Ruffin, a great play on Preston Fox. A reminder, we're going to see a lot of one-on-one competitions woven in throughout this spring game. Right now, wide receivers versus defensive backs. That's 2 points awarded for the defensive team, the blue team, and that has now tied the score at 16-16. One-on-ones will be worth 2 points. So here's another one. Oh, what a catch. No, he didn't catch it. But a good effort and a pass interference on the defense. We'll see how that one is scored. That was Devin Carter going up against Jacoby Spells, the sophomore defensive back.
Yeah, Jacoby Spells, he's one of the top cornerbacks. Very skilled, has good ball skills. But we also see how a big body like DC Carter can go up and get that ball and create some mismatches.
Okay, so we got a fan challenge here. Now, this is cool stuff. I mean, We've got Elliott against Camden. And if these kids are diehard Mountaineer fans, like I imagine they are, this has got to be an awesome opportunity.
Garrett being a quarterback, drawing up plays in the dirt. Just let a kid be a kid, Garrett. Come on.
This is like when you used to play football with your friends and you would draw the routes on your shirt, right? Okay, so we do get to see a little bit of action for Zach Frazier, the center who will be back at full strength in the fall. 34 games played, 33 career starts, including 25 in a row at center.
Oh, look at this coverage. He's already going underneath of it.
Oh, what a catch.
And he got behind him. Oh, that's awesome. That kid will never forget that. He'll never forget it.
Great ball by Garrett, too.
Nice soft toss. All right, here we go. So we get the defender. He's going for the underneath interception. Ball got behind him. Watch it all the way into the pocket. There's a celebration.
Terrific
that's
stuff.
Awesome.
Hey, so a reminder of the scheduled events for today's spring game, which, by the way, the gold team has racked up 4 more points from those 1v1, so it's now gold 20, blue 16. Gold's your offensive team. Blue is your defensive team. We're going to step aside for a quick break here on Big 12 Now on ESPN+. We'll reset the schedule of events for the day and have the second quarter of spring game action when we return. The Gold Blue Spring Game continues at Milan Pushkar Stadium with the gold team, the offensive team, leading the blue team 20-16. Here's a reminder of the competition schedule for today. We're about to resume normal scrimmaging between the ones and the twos. We'll have a pass protection, pass rush competition in just a bit. Coming up at halftime, important to note, the Iron Mountaineer Award winners will be named, as well as the 2023 recipient of the Tommy Nikolich Award, which is given to the program's most outstanding walk-on. Okay, gold team in possession again with a 1st and 10 from the 40-yard line. This is Garrett Green back at quarterback, going deep down the near sideline, incomplete through the arms of Cortez Braham, with Montre Miller, the transfer from Kent State, in coverage.
Yeah, good coverage right there again. Montre Miller right in position, and this is what the coaches are talking about. You know, these are final evaluations that's going to give them the comfort going into fall camp to let them know that, hey, listen, we don't need to go out to find any other guys. We have what we need on our roster. But I cannot speak highly enough of Cortez Braham. He's another one of the talented guys in that wide receiver room that I think they will try to use in their wide receiver packages this fall as well.
2nd and 10 from the 40. Green going to give it on a delay to Jalen Anderson for a gain of about 4. How about this stat line for Garrett Green in the first quarter? 12 rushing yards, 18 passing yards, 40 receiving yards, and a receiving touchdown. If you're joining us late, the big play of the first quarter was a reverse pass from Preston Fox, the Morgantown native, to Garrett Green for a touchdown.
It's the first of his kind ever for a quarterback. 40 receiving yards in the first quarter, more passing and rushing yards.
Although I do seem to remember, Rasheed, that in your junior year, you had 2 receptions for about maybe 40, 44 yards, something like that.
I did have a few receptions. I used to punt the ball.
I may have been on WVU stats doing some prep before today's game. 3rd and 7, 2nd quarter of action, ball at the 43. Green over the middle, and a good find to Hudson Clement, the Martinsburg native, inside the 40. Hershey McLaurin with the tackle for the blue team. But, hey, what about Hudson Clement, Rasheed, a kid that really could be in that conversation of wide receiver this year?
He's very smooth. He understands the game well. He's a great route runner. And most importantly, he catches the football. His nickname around the building is Huddy Tutty. So, you know, he's definitely a player, and it's good to see local talent because, you know, state of West Virginia, these guys can get excited about, you know, being recruited and having an opportunity to come to play here.
Green, this time he hits Cortez Braham to the 15, 10, 5, touchdown for the gold team.
There it is. Just talked about how talented he is. I'm sure he's been itching to get that play underneath his belt. He's worked hard all spring. And again, I'm very high on him. I like him as a player. I like the way he worked. But that was a great route. He was able to cross the defender's face. There it is. Again, you have to respect that run game. Quick poke fake by Garrett Green. And that's Miller in coverage. But Cortez Braham won that battle.
Second touchdown for GG. He's going for the trifecta in the spring game. He's now got a passing touchdown to go along with that receiving touchdown. A reminder, XFL rules on conversions. It looks like this will be a two-point conversion for the offense with an attempt from the 5-yard line. If you go for it from the 2 or kick an extra point, you get 1. From the 5, it's 2 points. From the 10, it's 3 points. So as it stands, gold 26, blue 16, getting the conversion set to go. New offensive lineman in there as well, by the way, for the gold team. First stringers were in to start. Now down the depth chart to the 2s. Here's Green from the shotgun. He's got Jalen Anderson to his right. Looking for Braham again. Goes to the back of the end zone to Clement. It's incomplete. So the score will stay gold 26, blue 16. Hey, before the game outside the stadium, West Virginia's own Philip Bowen provided a free concert for fans. The million follower man on TikTok joins our Amanda Mazey down at the sideline. What's going on, Amanda?
Well, just hanging out with Philip Bowen here. You're like kind of naked, no instrument with you. Are you okay?
No fiddle, no guitar. I feel okay, though. I feel okay, yeah.
How was that concert beforehand?
It was amazing. It's always fun to play in Morgantown for the home crowd. Love doing it, so I had a good time.
You are just making a name for yourself. You have over a million followers on TikTok. What has the past couple of years meant for you?
I would say it's been totally surreal, you know, to kind of chase a dream and see it to start to come to life. So it's been incredible, and to be able to do stuff here with WVU is always a treat, for sure.
And you've been able to, like, kind of collaborate with some, like, yeah, big-time musicians. Tell us about that.
Yeah, I've got some, you know, I've played on a lot of people's records. I've got a new album coming out, like, with Charles Wesley Godwin on the track and some other folks that I really enjoy playing with, so it's been awesome.
We have enjoyed your music. We cannot wait to see you just keep moving up in the musician world and representing West Virginia, so thanks for joining us.
I appreciate it.
Absolutely. Nick?
Appreciate that. Hey, that's a completion from Nico Markiel to Devin Carter. We were talking about him a moment ago, the transfer from NC State, who's entering his 6th season of college football, has 1 to play at West Virginia. 1st and 10 upcoming from the 41 for the gold team, which leads by 10. A reminder at halftime, the team will name its Iron Mountaineer Award winners as well as the winner of the Tommy Nikolich Award. Hand off to C.J. Donaldson, who tumbles forward for a gain of about 3. Aubrey Burks, the safety from Florida, in there for the tackle.
Speaking of Aubrey Burks, he's a very smart football player. He's one of the guys on this team, special teams defensively. He just has a great football mind, and he understands the game really well. He's going to be a big benefit for this defense this upcoming fall. Understands defense inside and out, has a lot of respect throughout the entire roster of players here. So
Burks entering his junior season, one of the vets, started all 12 games a year ago for the old Golden Blue. 2nd and 7 for Markiel and the gold team. The give is to Donaldson. Bunch of guys in there to make the stop. One of them, Hammond Russell, the native of Dublin, Ohio.
Big Ham Russell. Another guy fighting for some playing time. Sat down and talked with him yesterday about some of his short-term and long-term goals, which is part of my role here now with this football team. But just to be able to get these guys focused and looking at the long-term and the big picture of it all. It was a great conversation with him, but he has some things in store, and I'm looking forward to seeing what he's able to contribute to this defense in the fall as well.
Under 6.5 to go in the second quarter. Markiel with a 3rd and 7 for the gold team. Over the middle to Cole Taylor. What a grab by the big tight end inside the 35 for a first down.
That doesn't surprise me one bit. He's done this countless times throughout the spring, and he makes it look effortless. You can see he gets that right hand up. He's able to pull it right back in. Just so smooth he goes up, he's able to pull it back in. And it's almost like he practices it. But he's done it a number of times throughout the spring.
6'7", 243-pound junior from Grand Junction, Colorado. A huge frame that a lot of his teammates, man, they've said to me, this kid can really play. He's going to be a great threat for them next season.
Yep, runs great routes. He can help out on the offensive line in the run game. He's a extremely versatile player.
So Markio marching them forward inside the 40 with a fresh set of downs. Looking for Preston Fox, a bit overthrown, incomplete. Floyd and Burks in coverage for the blue team.
Yeah, good job on the defensive end. So what the offense was trying to do there, they wanted to hit a wheel route. So you can take the inside slot, send him up the rail. You take the outside receiver, bring him down the seam, and basically the two safeties were able to sit back in coverage and defend that very well.
You know, Rashid, you were mentioning a moment ago your role as the director of player relations at WVU came back here about, what, a month, maybe 6 weeks ago, right? How fun has it been to be back?
It's been great. You know, and I wanted to make sure that these guys know that I'm back in a different capacity. I'm not carrying any baggage from, you know, what I did here as a player. Yes, it's great if it comes up in conversation, but I will not be the guy to, you know, walk around and talk about, hey, what I did back in my day. It's a completely different capacity for why I'm here.
So we've got a 3rd and 3 coming up for the offense with 5 minutes to go in the second quarter of the Gold Blue game. Gold team leading by 10. Head coach Neil Brown in the midst of his 5th spring with the Mountaineers, getting ready for his 5th regular season. 3rd and 3. Markio under center for the first time. The give to Donaldson right up the middle is snuffed out by the blue defense. See Hershey McLaurin and Marcus Floyd in there for the stop.
Yeah, that was a good job by the defensive line up front. Again, we talked about how big CJ is and how much weight he carries. And hey, if that guy falls forward, in most cases, he's going to be able to get positive yards. But again, kudos to the defensive line and linebackers plugging those holes up front.
So that's a defensive stop that should be good for 3 more points for the blue team. Although we are going to see a field goal attempt here. This is Michael Hayes, the transfer from Georgia State and a native of South Carolina. Kicked and punted at Georgia State last season, went 11 for 14 on his field goal attempts and 41 for 42 on extra points. And that one off the upright from about 45 yards.
I've seen him nail those all spring. I'm sure he's down about that. He'll get another opportunity at some point.
Just didn't want to go. Curled right back to the far side upright. So we'll see how they officially score that, if they award 3 points to the blue team for a defensive stop. As it stands, the scoreboard still reads 26-16. And I just don't want to jump the gun because, you know, kind of Coach Brown is calling the shots here today, not me. So we'll see how the official scoring goes before we talk about it. Hey, a lot of stuff changing in the Big 12 Conference this year and throughout college football. The league in 2023 is going to expand to 14 teams with the addition of BYU, Cincinnati, Houston, and UCF. And in fact, the Mountaineers are going to play all 4 of those newcomers this season. And then following the 2023 campaign, the Big 12 will be truly a 12-team league as Oklahoma and Texas make their joint exit to the SEC. New drive underway for the gold team, led by Markiel again, overthrown to Williams, the Alabama native. So 2nd and 10 upcoming from the 30.
Yeah, another play for Nico trying to make a play outside of the pocket. One thing I think people don't understand as a left-handed quarterback, that's the direction he chooses to go. That's where he feels most comfortable, rolling to his left as a left-handed quarterback. You don't have to get those shoulders back around, but in most cases, you want to be able to see that completion at the end of that pass.
2 receivers to the far side, 1 to the near side. This time it's a handoff for a gain of about 5. Justin Johnson, the St. Louis, Missouri native, with the carry to set up a 3rd and medium.
Yep, first time we called his name, but again, wanted other backs in that talented running back room. But, you know, I think he's one of the more complete backs. You can use him in the pass receiving game. He's a good ball carrier as well, understands pass protection. Just good overall back.
Johnson rushed for 430 yards last season, has played in 20 career games at WVU. Donaldson, Mathis, and Johnson all went for over 400 yards apiece last season. The give is back to Johnson. This time he goes right. He might be able to churn forward for a first down on that third and four, and he does. Give him a gain of five for a fresh set of downs for the offense.
And if we get a replay here, one thing about him that I've noticed, his stop-start ability is probably one of the best that I've seen. We'll get a quick look right here, stop-start, quick hesitation, but he's able to get right back to top speed and keep those legs turning and get positive yardage. Good job by him.
Man, Coach Scott, the offensive coordinator and running backs coach, he is going to be spoiled for choice this season between the four running backs that are returning from last year. All six of West Virginia's top rushers from a season ago, including Green and Markiel, are back. Markiel's going deep to Braham. Good defending again by Montre Miller on this near side for an incompletion.
Well, Cortez won that last battle. Montre Miller had to make up for it, but good ball right there, I thought, by Nico. He didn't turn his head, but hey, we didn't get the flag. And for Miller, that's a win.
Just over.
Shaking off some of the cobwebs as well. Spring ball for them.
Fair point. It's still the spring for everybody, right? Second and 10 from the 40. 2:11 to go until halftime. Give again to Johnson on the far side, breaking free and tumbling forward once more for a gain of about six. Ben Cutter with the stop.
Ben Cutter, young freshman, who I really like a lot. I think he understands the game well to be a young player, but good vision right there by Justin Johnson, able to read his blocks, and again, just that stop-start ability is so quick, so sudden, and getting some north-south positive yardage. Good run by him.
Third and four from the 46 with a 1:40 to go until halftime. Two receivers on the far side for Markiel, one to the near side. It's Preston Fox. Give us to Jalen Anderson, who's bottled up by the defense, short of the stick. Reminder that coming up at halftime, we'll chat with Amy Bush of WVU Medicine Children's Hospital, the COO, and we'll also name the winner of the Tommy Nikolich Award for the top walk-on in the program, as well as the Iron Mountaineer Award. Four of them given to the most outstanding performers in West Virginia's strength and conditioning offseason program. Okay, blue team does get 3 points for the defensive stop just shy of midfield. So the gold team leads by a traditional touchdown and extra point, 26-19 with 1:22 to go until halftime. Nick Farrell here alongside Rasheed Marshall, the former Big East Offensive Player of the Year. Amanda Mazey is the third member of our crew. We were just talking about the scoring, so let's recap it just in case you're joining us late. There's a lot going on today and a lot to keep track of. Touchdowns and field goals remain the same for the offense. 6 points for a TD, 3 points for a field goal. But how does the defense score? Well, can get 7 points for a three and out, 7 points for a defensive turnover, or a defensive stop that apparently does not lead to a field goal attempt is also good for 3 points for the defense. Also got XFL style conversions after a touchdown. 1 point from the 2 yard line, 2 points from the 5 yard line, 3 points from the 10 yard line.
And after all of that, let's not forget at the end of this game, the head ball coach has the final say-so as to which one of these teams is going to have, I'm not going to say a certain amount of points, but which team comes out on top for the most part.
Very fair point. I did read somewhere in some of the confidential pregame information that was given to us that in the event of a tie, there will be tie-breaking procedures. So, you know, he wants to foster competition and pressure. That's one thing he was telling us this week. And what better way to do that than with a game on the line at the very end?
And that's what it's all about. He always tries to come up with a very competitive atmosphere, because at the end of the day, and this is one thing that Daryl Talley preached as well, it's all about competing all the way to the end. Yes, these are your teammates, but you have to get it into your mind that, listen, at the end of the day, all fall, we're going to have to continue to work to find an edge to beat some of these teams that we're going up against this fall.
Garrett Green back at quarterback for the gold team. He has a passing touchdown of 40 yards to Cortez Braham and a receiving touchdown of 40 yards from Preston Fox. Green throws one to Jalen Anderson. Anderson gains about six. Looks like he stepped out shy of the first down stick. Keyshawn Cobb is the player who forced him out. So it'll be second and four. That, by the way, I believe is the eighth different receiver who's caught a pass for the Gold team today.
Yeah, we've called Keyshawn Cobb's name a few times. Good safety coming down and run support. And he's not a small guy either. Not afraid to come up and sniff out some of that action, helping out in run support.
Reminder, standard clock rules here in the first half. We'll move to a running clock in the second half of this spring scrimmage. Second and four, buck 16 to go. Ball at the 36. Snap from Brandon Yates to Garrett Green, who finds Cole Taylor to the 41. Good for a Gold team first down.
And I talked about some of the versatile ways that they're able to use Cole. You can split him out. Again, I talked about his route running ability, but he's going to be able to create some mismatches for sure.
That's a feed to Devin Carter. His second reception should be good for another first down. Gain of about 11. Green and the Gold offense moving quickly. Final minute of the first half. Two-minute drill on for sure. Going deep this time for sideline, and it's broken up by Malachi Ruffin, the 5'10 redshirt junior with a big play.
And listen, you have to give Malachi a lot of credit here. This guy's been playing with a cast on his left hand pretty much all spring, but he was able to get his head around, made a good play on the football, and that's, again, what gives those defensive coaches the confidence heading to fall camp.
What a tremendous story Ruffin is, player from North Carolina who didn't have a D1 offer, walked on at WVU, literally said to the coaching staff, I'm here to try out. And he's worked his way all the way up to a starting role last season, 33 career games played, 5 career starts. Second and 10, Green dancing with it, has a man open. Braham just can't reel it in with that outstretched left hand. It's Ruffin in coverage once again for the Blue team.
Yeah, we'll see on the replay here. Garrett, again, just showing us why he's so dangerous outside of the pocket. But the one thing that I want people to understand here, his eyes are still down the field. He's not looking around with the football. He's outside of the pocket, trying to make a play outside, but still with his arm, not his legs.
Third and 10 coming from the Gold team and the offense from the 47. Looks like Traylon Davis is in there at tight end for West Virginia. Here's Green. Tucking it, scrambling to his left, looking for an option. He's going to take it himself. Needed to get to the 37 for the first down. Ushered out of bounds by Day-Day Hawkins at about the 41.
So this is a great point right here, because just as I talk about with Nico Markiel getting outside of the pocket, going to his left, Garrett being a right-handed quarterback scrambling to his left, that's an extremely hard throw. You have to be able to get your shoulders back around. And Garrett came up a little gimpy.
Mm-mm. Well, Green stays out there, fourth and four with a ball at the 41. Definitely a fighter. We already knew that. Coach Brown wants to see clean football today. That's on his wish list. Fourth and four. Green to his right. Pressured and tagged by Lee Koba, the senior linebacker and former Syracuse Orange, with the stop. And that should be good for points for the Blue team.
Yeah, Lee Koba's one of the guys who's, again, truly a veteran for this defense. He's been around for a long time. He's played at Syracuse, as you mentioned. But he's literally the lifeline of this defense. A lot of energy, high-energy guy, and brings it every single day.
So they've awarded 6 points to the Blue team for that stop. Remember that our cheat sheet says 3 points for a defensive stop. Well, how about six? Because we're trying to keep this close and competitive, right, Rashid? I think that's the message. So 26 for the Gold team, 25 for the Blue team, with half a minute to go until halftime. So we should have time perhaps for one more possession here before halftime. Well, it looks like the clock is just running now. The clock is going to run down to halftime with the score Gold 26, Blue 25. So, Rashid, while we have 20 seconds, your thoughts on the first half?
I think the guys look great. I think they were able to put some things on film that these coaches are going to be able to look at. Yes, you can always make corrections, but they also made a lot of good plays as well.
We'll step aside for a quick break here on Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus. The Pass Pro competition is next. The Go Blue Spring Game continues live from Mylan Pushkar Stadium in Morgantown, West Virginia, here on Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus. Nick Farrell here alongside Rasheed Marshall and Amanda Mazey. It's technically not halftime just yet. Time for another one-on-one competition, the Pass Pro Pass Rush competition. I know, Rasheed, you're fired up for this one.
Listen, this is the one I wanted everyone to see, because if it's anything like it is at practice, we're going to get a kick out of it. The fans, everyone's going to love this drill.
One-on-one, right tackle, Wyatt Milam against Edward Vesterinen.
So basically what's happening here is this simulates the pass. He simulates Coach A.J. Jackson. Oh, that's hilarious. But this simulates what it's like as a quarterback being protected in a pocket. So you're going to get each guy going from left to right and get the left tackle, left guard. AJ.
I mean, Eddie's a big guy, though. 6'3", 284, coming at you all fired up.
Yeah, there's no excuse to hit the ground. Yeah, so you get one shot, all right? So you're coming off of the ball. If you can get your hands basically to the manager who's directly behind the center, that counts as a sack. And these guys are going to have to hold up on the offensive line. Defensive guys, they can use their spin move. They can use their bull rush, the swim technique. And as we see right there, that's a great bull rush right there by Mike coming off of that nose position.
Well, Doug Nestor, who was the center for that one, the Canova, West Virginia native, saying, I think I won that one.
With Doug Nestor getting into his pass set.
So the score has changed. Gold team 30, blue team 27. So gold has won two of these 1v1s, blue winning one, the one on Edward Vesterinen.
Yeah, so again, this is the one-on-one pass pro, pass rush drill. When you see the whole makeup of it, you get the whole offensive line, you get the whole defensive line. But what you don't understand is that there are individual battles going all the way from left tackle, left guard, center, right guard, right tackle. And each one of those guys are pretty much responsible for any twist, any one-on-one battles up there. And this basically just magnifies that and allow these guys to go one-on-one.
Okay, we've got two Mountaineer maniacs going head-to-head here for the fan competition. All right, let's see how this goes. No helmets, no shoulder pads. This is legit stuff. Man, Tim Flynn, the wrestling coach, might need to get these young men on the phone. Come on. Come on, man. This spring game is not just another practice. This means something to these guys.
Yes,
for
it
sure.
Does. But listen, even more to those fans. Again, this is something that they'll remember for the rest of their lives. You don't have a helmet on. You're going out there. You're going as hard as you possibly can. You have to watch the hands through the face. So those guys did a good job of keeping the hands within the framework and no punches to the face for the most part.
Amanda Mazey has Neil Brown. Hey, Amanda.
Hey, Nick. Okay, so Neil, were you just recruiting those two guys? What'd you think?
Oh, hey, did you see the pass protection? I mean, the guy, his elbows were tight, had the punch. I mean, he did better than our guys.
Ooh, the gauntlet has been laid down. Hey, what'd you think of that first half? Garrett looked pretty comfortable out there. Some big plays, had a receiving touchdown as well. But your assessment on the offense for the first half?
Yeah, so I thought Garrett operated really well. Didn't execute in the 2 minute like we'd want to. But I thought he threw the ball well. He had a couple nice runs. I thought the offensive line did a nice job. CJ had a couple nice runs. I thought Tony Mathis did a nice job with some limited carries. And then Cole Taylor had probably the play of the half with the one-handed grab. And it was good to see Jeremiah Aaron make a play across the middle as well.
Defensively, your assessment?
Well, probably a couple sacks that they probably would have gotten home. We kind of let them play. I thought Lee Koba, for sure, on one pass rush, got home. And then he made two nice plays and short yardage runs.
What are we going to see in the second half?
Well, we're going to
everybody here is going to play and want to continue to see the quarterbacks operate with people in the stands. Want to get the guys on the edge a little bit, see if we can run the ball on the perimeter. And then defensively, want to challenge the corners. I thought they played the deep ball really well, which is encouraging and something we've got to get better at. So want to challenge them downfield and see how they react.
All right, keep having fun. Thanks, Coach. We'll check in with you at the end of the game.
Thank you.
Nick?
Thanks, Amanda. Halftime officially underway at the Gold Blue Spring Game with the gold team leading the blue team 30-27. The CEO of WVU Medicine Children's Hospital, Amy Bush, joins us next on ESPN+. Nick Farrell here alongside Amy Bush, the Chief Administrative Officer of WVU Medicine Children's Hospital. It's halftime here on Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus at the Gold Blue Spring Game. Amy, thanks so much for being with us. I know that this game has such an important place, both with the football team and with the Children's Hospital. How important is this partnership between the two units?
Well, thank you, Nick. You know, this goes all the way back to like the early 1980s with Coach Nealon, and he wanted to add the players to his team roster, and so it's just carried forward since then, and we're just really appreciative of the partnership to bring sunshine really to the life of the kids who are sick, and the players do that for these kids.
So there are so many opportunities, and Rashid Marshall, our color analyst today, was talking about those opportunities that he had as a player and has had since he's come back. What do those opportunities to volunteer mean both for the players and for the kids?
You know, now that we're in our new children's hospital, we just crossed the 6-month mark, our Family Resource Center is a really special place for the players. You know, they wave to the kids who line up in there, but they also come over and they can play games with the kids. And you just see the kids forget about their illness for a brief period of time. But, you know, I think those kids are heroes to the football players, too.
Well, that children's hospital that we were just looking at is absolutely outstanding. I've had the opportunity to be up on the Hostetler Family Resource Center floor. The view of Mylan Pushkar Stadium from there is absolutely fantastic. How has it been received by the families of the children at the hospital?
You know, the families love just to have a place to get away. And, you know, even if they can take their child there and just have a moment, watch a movie, play games, watch sports, have food. And you know, we have our school teacher program there, a place to do laundry. It's a really multi-use space, but it's much appreciated.
And there's so much there, right? It's entertainment for the kids and their families. It's cooking. It's laundry. It's anything that you might not realize that you'd need in a situation like that, but you do need. It's there and accessible.
You know, no one ever expects their little one to get sick, usually. And so you kind of pack up and go without notice. And so that Family Resource Center is a place to provide meal cards and gas cards or laundry, like you say, and just sort of like the living room of the home away from home while the kids are sick.
So the hospital is here. It's beautiful. It's been operating for nearly 6 months. What's next for the Children's Hospital?
No, we want to continue to take great care of the kids and their families, continue to build our subspecialty program, but Children's is all around the state and the region. And so, you know, where we can take care close to home, we want to do that. And when kids need something more specialized, then we want them to come here to our Children's Hospital.
That phrase, a beacon of hope, is such a great descriptor of the hospital.
It really is. You know, we have the only heart program in the state, ECMO, which people learn a lot about during COVID, and we are the only level 4 neonatal ICU in the state, amongst other things, and it's just a real honor to be able to be trusted to take care of the kids.
Amy Bush, the Chief Administrative Officer of WVU Medicine Children's Hospital, with us here on Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus. Amy, thanks for your time.
Thank you, Nick.
The gold team leads the blue team at halftime. We'll be back with the second half of action in just a moment. It's halftime at the Gold Blue Spring Game at Mylan Pushkar Stadium. The team is issuing its spring awards, the Iron Mountaineer Award and the Tommy Nikolich Award. We'll recap those and tell you more about them in just a bit. While we were away and chatting with Amy Bush, the Chief Administrative Officer at WVU Medicine Children's, there was more competition, and yet again, the score changed on us, right? The blue team now leads the gold team 35-32. So not very often that you see more scoring at halftime, Rashid Marshall, but I guess anything is possible during the Gold Blue game.
That's exactly right. So again, let's not forget, Coach Neil Brown has the final say so on what happens.
That's right. So again, we'll recap scoring for you. Typical scoring for the offense: a touchdown is 6 points, a field goal is 3 points. XFL style conversions for the offense as well: a 1-point conversion from the 2, a 2-point conversion from the 5, a 3-point conversion from the 10. For defense, A three and out is a 7-point score for the D. A defensive turnover is also a 7-point score. Any other defensive stop is a 3-point score, although we have seen one awarded 6 points. So we'll see if we can go with the flow here in the second quarter or second half of action. Awards show still happening. We are about to name the Tommy Nikolic Award winner. Earlier this spring, we had Coach Brown mic'd up. Got to see a little bit of what spring practice is like from his vantage point.
Hey, listen, stacking days, right? Yeah, stacking days. Just remember, pad level, right? Okay. Significantly better the first 2 days. You know what I mean? And what I mean by better is playing hard, all right, trying to do your technique. Now you just got to stack those days, right? Excited for you, man. Feel more comfortable?
Yes, sir.
Huh? Yeah. A little different than the fall?
Yeah.
A little more energy?
Yeah.
Yeah. Good. I mean, they're rolling deep, right? You got like 8 or 10 people coming today. First day in pads, huh?
Yeah, I'm excited.
Just relax. Know what to do. If you make mistakes, make them full speed, right? It's about urgency, okay? Urgency. Like, this is the only third practice we get all spring. We got to be urgent about it. You think about this. 28 days to the spring game. 28 days, that's it. Short amount of time. Won over 70% of our games at home. Okay, some legends, like the guys that are fresh in your mind. All right, Pac-Man, Geno, like those legends were made in that stadium. There's a lot of people that came before you that made their name in that stadium before they went and did it at the highest level. So you got to understand. So when you go in that stadium, there is something special to that. So don't just take it for granted. We're just going in here. No. Like, we specifically only go in that stadium during spring and fall camp on Saturdays. They said you came in late last night, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, good. Good to see you. I saw where y'all been getting into, what's it called? Pickleball. Make yourself at home, though. I want you to talk to the team at the end. Where are we in? What season are we in right now? Fishing season?
Well, it's going to be trout season, but I don't like getting rained on. I got new electronics on my boat, 2 12-inch screens. I'm ready to go.
You're always ready.
He's ready. Yeah. Oh, he's always ready. You don't wake up and say, man, I got to make sure they get the class, treatment. Hey, turn the music up. There you go. Good. Hey, great job. Nice job. Hey, let's go. Be fast. Line up fast. Hey, what's up, Pat? Give me one word of advice.
Best advice.
That's what spring practice looks like from Coach Brown's perspective. Halftime rolls along here at the Gold Blue Spring Game at Mylan Pushkar Stadium. Third quarter will begin right after this. Third quarter of the Gold Blue Spring Game about to begin with a punt competition. And then more live action will resume with the blue team leading the gold team by 3 as the third quarter is about to begin. We welcome you inside the booth along with Rasheed Marshall and the director of athletics, Ren Baker. I'm Nick Farrell. Ren, thanks so much for doing this with us. I guess this is technically your first game day at Mylan Pushkar Stadium, is it not? Even though it's not a fall game day. Kind of close.
It is. I got a chance to start the morning off in the tailgate area and hear a little of Philip Bowen's concert, spend a little time with some of the fans out there, and then I've been walking around suites and just checking everything out, and it's been a lot of fun.
So you're through what your first maybe 4 or 5 months as the director of athletics. How has this transition process gone for you, Ren? Is it what you thought it would be?
Yeah, it has been. The people here, and I'd heard that so much, but you really have to get here to experience how incredible people here really are. I mean, they're very, very welcoming, very kind. I grew up in rural Oklahoma, and I think the people here remind me a lot of the people that I grew up with. My wife and daughters are still in Texas. They're finishing out the school year, so that's a little bit challenging, but we'll get them here sometime early to mid-June. But I can't say enough about just the way people have made me feel. I've been given more treats and snacks, and so I'm trying to hold down my cholesterol and my weight and all that stuff, but it's not easy to do here.
You got a pepperoni roll or two or 10 probably, right?
There's no question. And you know, what here, our security people that work the games for us, there's several of them that bake goods.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and they all recognize, so they're holding them for me, and then I feel obligated to eat them, you know. So, yeah, so I need to hang out with this guy right here and work out a little bit. I see him. He's never eating. He's always working out.
You and me both, yeah. Ren. Honestly, I could probably spend a little bit more time with Rasheed. And it's all about knowing the right people on game days to make sure you get fed well. In your first 4 months, new women's basketball head coach had to make a hire. The state of the athletic department moving forward into next academic year, the 2023-24 school year.
Yeah, first I'd say I'm just really excited about Coach Kellogg. You know, I wasn't anticipating that would be a job that would come open here early because Don had only been here for a short period of time. But I was really pleased. I knew Mark a little bit, had worked with him before. I didn't bring him up initially in the committee. I wanted him to come up from other people. We were all taking turns looking at different conferences, and he did come up from other committee members. And I finally told him, hey, I actually have worked with him before. But he's done a tremendous job here of onboarding. Building a staff. You know, we've been able to retain most of the players on that team. And the day of the portal, that's really saying something. Mm-hmm. And he's brought others in. So excited about women's basketball. Men's basketball has done a great job of bringing in some portal kids as well. And so there's a lot of excitement around basketball and a lot of excitement around football. If you've been out here much at practice, been around these kids, the chemistry is really, really good. I had a chance to sit with every member of the staff when I was first onboarding. And to a person, they all said the culture and the chemistry of this team is different than all the teams that they've coached since they've arrived. And so I'm very, very excited about the future.
I guess the only thing for me, Ren, is, and you as well, I will extend my invitation for us to get together for a workout
since we already put it out there. Sounds good.
All right.
Sounds good.
Yeah. I feel like it's a good way for me to have a hospital with the rest, though.
Let's make it happen.
We can go for
a nice walk around Law School Hill. We'll keep it simple.
I love that. That's nice and simple. So we've got a big bomb here from Garrett Green to Devin Carter. All right, Ren, your chance to break it down here.
Yeah, let's see here. I feel like a few of the workouts with Rasheed, and he would have broke that tackle and took it to the end zone. Great catch. Has to get a few of these workouts with you.
Yeah. Listen, these guys work hard. As I mentioned, Coach Joseph, he gets these guys going. But, yeah, that was D.C. right there, had a step on. I think that was Jacoby Spells, if I'm not mistaken. But, again, D.C. just brings a physical presence, has great ball skills. And right there, that's one of the ways that he is going to be able to help this team out this upcoming fall for sure.
Here's a give to C.J. Donaldson as the ones continue on here in the third quarter with the gold team leading the blue team, but the gold team knocking on the door. Ren, you mentioned that chemistry. That is so important for a football team. And heading into 2023, you know, you can look in certain places on this roster and say, okay, lost some players to the transfer portal or to graduation. Really does seem like Coach Brown has a fine core here for this season.
No, and you know, Rasheed's been in a lot of locker rooms. I have been not as a participant of a team, but I've been in a lot of locker rooms. It doesn't take you very long to feel when that chemistry isn't right, whether that's with the staff or with the team or wherever it is. And it is amazing when you fight for your teammate, your colleague next to you, and you don't care who gets the credit, what you can accomplish together. And this team gives you that sense. They really do.
Well, let's get another look at this trademark C.J. Donaldson run, Rasheed. He is hard to tackle.
Yes, he is. And as I mentioned, listen, at 240 pounds, all you need to do is let physics work. You're going to get moving. You're going to get that momentum. He's going to fall forward. And right there, again, number four, just doing what we've seen him do all his career at WVU so far. So he's going to continue to make big plays for this offense.
Okay, so it looks like we've got a standard point after coming here. Remember, XFL rules for conversions. Could go for two from the five, could go for three from the 10. A one-pointer here would make it 41-35 if it converts. I didn't go to college to do math, but I can do that math, Ren.
What would you do here? Would you go for two?
Listen, spring game, I'm going for three. Why not? Let's just go for
yeah,
three.
Yeah, why not? Make
you know,
it
take
an eight-point
advantage.
Game
Let's
here,
go for
right?
The points.
Okay, so here's Garrett Green with Tony Mathis to his left. Boy, good pressure from the defense. That's Jai Favoris, who comes up with the ghost sack. So it'll stay 40-35. Gold team with 7:12 to go in the third quarter. Hey, Ren, while we have you, want to look ahead at the 2023 schedule. I know you got a taste of a backyard brawl a few nights ago when the baseball team played Pitt at PNC Park. Coming up on September 16th, the backyard brawl comes to Milan Puskar Stadium. I mean, that's going to be a cool day.
Yeah, that's going to be a lot of fun. You know, I haven't even been to an actual event yet. I wasn't able to make it up to Pittsburgh. I had a conflict. But I already can't walk through an airport or a restaurant and hear Sweet Caroline without that chant ringing in my ear. And I have to really fight to not just join in. And I try not to curse much, but that's one where you get a pass, I think. So I've quickly figured out how intense that rivalry is. And that's going to be a great game, a fun day here on campus. And we got some challenging games on the front end of that schedule. But if we can beat Pitt, win a couple of those early games, and then get in the Big 12 play, I think we got a chance to really do some great things throughout the year.
Nico back in there at quarterback. Sweep forward to Williams for a gain of about 2 yards. And Ren, tickets available now, WVUgame.com.
Yeah, we're actually trending really well in season tickets right now, ahead of really the last 4 or 5 years. It's a great time to get here and get tickets. I mean, people always say, what can we do to help you? Well, the first thing you can do is get here for Mountaineer Game Days. Bring your family. Have a great time. It's about the game. It's about the results on the field, but it's about rekindling old relationships, remembering what it feels like to be right here in Morgantown, and spend your day in almost heaven. And then, you know, sort support through the MAC. I'd also mention Country Roads Trust is another avenue that's really important, that we support their efforts a lot with the NIL collective. And so those are always people can support. But if you want a place to start, football tickets, coming here on game day, committing to 6 to 7 Saturdays in the fall, that's the best way to start. You're going to have a great time, your family's going to have a great time, and you're going to make memories that are going to last forever.
We've got Director of Athletics Ren Baker here in the booth with us during the Gold Blue Spring game at Milan Puskar Stadium. We're in the third quarter, just over 5 minutes to go, with a 3rd and 3 here for Nico Markiel. Bunch to the near side. He goes over the middle to Jalen Anderson, and it's incomplete. So that's good for a 3 and out, which will be points for the blue team. Hey, Rashid, we've got sights set on big number 61, Jimmy Bell, with his first action at right
tackle.
That's it.
Right tackle, number 61, towering over all the other offensive linemen. Listen, the first couple days he was here, some of the bigger guys on the offensive line said, listen, this Jimmy Bell is a monster, and they're monsters, at least in my eyes anyway. But listen, he's been doing a great job. Smooth transition for him since he's put the football helmet on, and just speaks volumes to his athleticism.
Jimmy Bell, native of Saginaw, Michigan, started all 34 games for the men's basketball team. And if you haven't been paying attention, he's on a trial run right now with Neil Brown's football program. He did play football in high school, had some interest from schools like Ohio State, Michigan State, committed to playing basketball, though, did a year of prep school, went to St. Louis, then went to junior college at Moberly area, then ended up with Bob Huggins
and
with the basketball team.
I'll mention something that you guys may or may not know. Everybody knows he's out here working with football. You know, Jimmy's a young man that has worked his tail off, lost a lot of weight, done what he's supposed to with his nutrition, but he's still working out with basketball. I popped my head in the gym at the basketball practice facility the other day, and he was going through workouts with basketball as well. So everybody talks about the time demands of a student athlete.
My goodness.
And they are incredible. Imagine doing that for two teams.
Yeah, it's an incredible story wherever he ends up. Get another look at him. I mean, he does, Rashid, just tower over everybody out there.
Yeah, so that's zone blocking up front, going to the left. But again, with those long arms and just that leg drive, the power, he's going to be able to move some guys out of the way.
By the way, Gold Team did get 7 points for that previous 3 and out. Here's a 2nd and 3. And a give from Markiel, and a big stop. A bunch of blue jerseys in there to make the tackle. It was Jaheim White, the true freshman from York, PA, on the carry there. Hey, Ren, I know you're a basketball guy. Did you play football growing up?
I did. So I grew up in a town where there was only 800 people in my hometown. So I always tell people I played baseball, football, basketball, and sang in the glee club. I played a little bit of everything growing up. By the time I got on into high school, I really was more focused on academics, being honest, I kind of figured out, like, I need to find a way to pay for college, and it's not going to be through sports. But growing up, my brother and I both played a little bit of everything. We even lived across the street from the tennis courts in town, the city park, and my brother played state and in tennis. So there's you kind of had to in those small towns, because they couldn't fill a team if everybody didn't.
Well, a huge thank you to the director of athletics, Ren Baker, for spending some time with us here during the spring game at Milan Pushkar Stadium. Ren, appreciate it, and
hey,
wish you the best moving forward.
Appreciate you
Ren,
guys. Thanks for having me.
We're going on that walk.
Yeah, we'll catch up soon. We'll make sure Rashid coordinates there. That's good stuff. All right, so after the sack, by the way, by the freshman Ben Cutter, it's a 2nd and 18 upcoming here for the gold team, which trails by a deuce in the third quarter. Blue team coming off a big 3-and-out a few moments ago to score 7 points. Nico Markiel still out there at QB for the gold team. Pops one quickly to Preston Fox. Rather, that's Will Dixon, the tight end, with the reception and short game.
That's another deep room in this building. Tight end. I mean, I've sat in on some of their meetings, and, man, that's a good group for Coach Blaine Stewart to have. All those guys are collective. They rally behind each other. They encourage each other. Really good group of guys right there.
So 3rd and 2 now after the third and 12, excuse me, after the short gain. Ball at the 35, inside of 2 minutes left in the third quarter. Markiel has 3 wide receivers to his left and a running back as well. Looking left, heaving, but the whistle blows the play dead for a sack for the blue team. It's Caden Beiser in there for the stop, the Kaiser, West Virginia native.
That's it, and again, I talk about that mental clock as a quarterback. Sometimes during spring drills, when you don't have that contact, it's hard for you to truly get a feel for what it's like being back there in the pocket as a live target. So that's a good feel for him. He's going to be able to continue to learn and, you know, just understand that he can hold on to the ball for as long as he has.
Okay, we told you at halftime that awards were being distributed by the coaching staff. The Iron Mountaineer Award, 4 recipients. They are Jared Bartlett, Marcus Floyd, Tony Mathis, and Doug Nesker. 3 of those guys are now multi-time winners. Bartlett, a bandit, he's a 2-time winner. So is Mathis, a running back, and Nestor, an offensive lineman. They joined Zach Frazier as the current guys on the roster who have won the Iron Mountaineer Award multiple times. Remember, that's given to the most outstanding performers in the team's strength and conditioning program, which is led by head coach for strength and conditioning, Mike Joseph, one of the most respected strength coaches in the country. And the Tommy Nikolich Award given to C.J. Cole, the native of Washington, Pennsylvania, a redshirt sophomore from McGuffey High School. That award given to the most outstanding walk-on in the program. He's the first Pennsylvania native to win that award since safety Usman Kamara won it in 2020. And Rashid, West Virginia has had a great walk-on program over the years. Many of the guys who have won that award have gone on to be scholarship recipients. But the Iron Mountaineer Award, you won that back in the day, right?
I did win that award myself. You know, the one thing I'll say is I've always taken my strength and conditioning, you know, very serious, because I know how important it is, and I knew how far was going to be able to carry my game. A lot of people think it's just lifting weights, but in actuality, it's injury prevention. It's allowing you to be able to stay out on the field much longer after taking those hits and delivering the hits as well.
Preston Fox with the reception. Jai Favaris in there for the stop. It's a 2nd and 6 upcoming with about 35 seconds to go in the third quarter. Garrett Green still out there at quarterback for the gold team. Here comes the 2nd and 6, man in motion. That's Grayson Malashevitz. The give is to Jaheim White, who bounces forward for a pickup of about 5. It should be a 3rd and 1, maybe 3rd and 2 as we end the third quarter.
Jaheim White, one of the young running backs who's extremely talented. I mean, the guy is built like he's just built like a brick. He really is. He's probably about 5% body fat. You can tell he's been in a weight room, and for a young guy, truly you don't get that type of development, but he stepped on campus ready to go, and he's been doing a great job.
New quarterback for the gold team, it's Sean Boyle, the true freshman out of Charleston, sorry, Charlotte Catholic in Charlotte, North Carolina. It's a third and one. And a give to the running back, Jaheim White, once again, and he is bottled up by a bunch of defenders. And that should take us to the end of the third quarter.
This is the end of the third quarter.
Blue team leads the gold team 45-40 as we head into the final period of the gold-blue spring game. 4th quarter of the gold-blue spring game continues with a kicking competition. Blue team, the defense, leading the gold team, the offense, 45-40. Nick Farrell here alongside with our analyst Rasheed Marshall and our sideline reporter Amanda Mazey. So happy that you've joined us this afternoon on Big 12 Now on ESPN Plus for the final rite of spring football. Not too early to look ahead to that very exciting 2023 schedule, which features some enticing non-conference competitions. The opener, September 2nd at Penn State. First meeting between those two teams in roughly 30 years. And then the second backyard brawl in a row, this time at Milan Puskar Stadium, West Virginia, hosting Pitt September 16th, 1 week after its home opener against Duquesne on September 9th. Rasheed, I know that one against Pitt means a lot to you.
It means a lot, and it should mean more to these players than it means to me. But yes, it does mean a lot. And, you know, we had a glance at the schedule from top to bottom. I mean, it's going to be tough, but you have to take it one game at a time. You truly have to just go from week to week. And first game out of the gate, we're going to have a tough opponent in Penn State, and that's where the focus has to be.
What do you think of playing the four newcomers to the Big 12 this season, BYU, UCF, Cincinnati, and Houston?
I think it's great. It provides more competition, but it also gives us some familiarity with Cincinnati, with UCF. We've played some of those teams before. So I think in terms of old Big East style, and I know this is all Big 12 right now, but it does bring for fans some old memories back.
So the blue team just got a point for a Michael Hayes field goal attempt. That's Danny King, the redshirt junior from Cumberland, Maryland, who just split the uprights for the gold team. So scratch that. 3 points awarded for the blue team on the Hayes kick and 3 by the Danny King kick. And we've got another fan with an opportunity to get on the field. 2 fans with opportunities to get on the field and kick one. Rasheed, you threw passes, you ran, you caught passes, you even punted, but did you place kick?
I've never place kicked. And unless that ball was coming off of a tee, I'll probably never be able to place kick in my life.
But you think you're good from, like, extra point distance, maybe?
I could probably bang one from 15. I'll say 15, straight on approach. I'm not backing off to the side. I'm going straight on, you know? Give me the flat toe.
Okay. If nobody's out there guarding it, you just got to get it through, right? I don't know. I think I could go from extra point distance. I know nobody asked, but just for the record. So 2 fans, we've seen some really great fan competition. The pass pro competition with the fans was probably one of the highlights of the day at halftime. 2 fans, no pads, no helmets, getting after it. Uh-oh. They're not going to let her take that again. I'm hearing the on-field MC saying that the field goal tee was placed upside down. That sounds like a dirty trick.
Reset.
Get in there. Oh.
Thought she had the height for it.
Yeah, looked good. Looked good from up here. Allie's her name. Let's get one more look.
Hey, listen, I must say, I like the approach.
Right.
I like the approach.
Okay, so Allie got better every time, but I think still went 0-for-3. So now we've got our second fan competitor. 3 attempts for the fans. Close. Had the height.
Now she needs a little bit of distance on it.
Well, we've had a fun day here at Milan Puskar Stadium. Really solid performances from a handful of guys. Big offensive plays. Garrett Green with a 40-yard strike to Cortez Braham, as well as a 40-yard reception. How about that? That was a good-looking kick.
There's been something about Grayson today.
That's right.
That's been making people winners.
Grayson Malashevitz, the wide receiver, scored points before the game even began for his fit. And now we've got Grayson kicking field goals.
I had a feeling she was going to go. She was going to even up the score.
Got it again.
Two for three. Look at the follow through right down the middle.
And the flex. Love that.
Danny
that's
King
what
better,
it's all about.
Better watch his job.
So that's more points for the Gold team. It's a one-point game as we enter the fourth quarter of the Gold Blue Spring game. The exciting conclusion of the Gold Blue Spring game is upon us. Fourth quarter of action beginning with the blue team, the defensive team, leading the gold team, the offensive team, 48-47. The true freshman Sean Boyle in there to quarterback the gold team. First and 10 from the 43-yard line. And I think we saw the 6'10 big man for the WVU basketball team in there, Jimmy Bell on the offensive line. Here's Boyle. Scrambling with it, gaining a good chunk for about 5 yards.
I started laughing because all of these quarterbacks do the exact same thing when they get out of the pocket, and I did the same exact thing. So if you don't get touched, you think you have a clear-cut path to the house, but in actuality, in a real game situation, they would have probably converged and, you know, you go down. But I'm laughing because Sean, he heard the whistle and looked back and thinking, hey, I'm off to the races. Why are we stopping this play?
Garrett had one of those too at the end of the first half. Same deal. Here's Boyle again, second and 6. The give is to Jaheim White, another freshman beyond midfield. A big break here for Jaheim White. Off to the races. 10-5, touchdown.
Wow.
What a run by Jaheim White. Hits the gritty in the back of the end zone. The gold team takes the lead.
Well, I told you, he's very talented. I mean, the kid is fast. He pays attention. We'll see right here off of the right side of the line. And that's what coaches love to see. It's the extra effort. And then he's able to get into that open field, hit the extra gear, and the gritty. Now, I must say, be careful in the fall, young man, because if you get a flag thrown on you,
that's right.
It's not
going to
be
trouble.
Pretty. Spring game, a little different situation. Have your fun. But I'm sure he'll hear about that one, I promise you.
So it's 53-48, gold in the lead. Ball spotted at the 5-yard line. This will be a 2-point conversion attempt to make it a 7-point game. And that's significant because the defense could score 7 points on a 3-and-out or on a defensive turnover. And we'll have a timeout here. While we have a moment, we'll toss it down to our sideline reporter, Amanda Mazey, who's with Bryce Ford Wheaton. What's going on, Amanda?
That's Coach Bryce Ford Wheaton today. Coach, what's your assessment of this game so far?
I think it's looked really good right now, honestly. A lot of points, big plays. We just had one right there by a freshman, so they're looking good right now. And, it's going good.
You're not too far removed from being a Mountaineer. You have the draft coming up next week, so let's talk about your plans for that and just how excited you are to possibly hear your name called.
Yeah, I'm really excited. I'm going back home to North Carolina, going to be with my family, a small little get-together and stuff, so it'll be nice, just family and close friends.
How fun is it to be here on the sideline? Do you wish you were out there?
It's kind of different, honestly. Like, I had to walk around. I have this pass and everything now, so it's just, you know, crazy. Like, I was just out there a few months ago with them, so now to see them out here and I'm in a different role, just crazy.
What would you say to these guys out here? Any advice as a now former Mountaineer?
I just say, just keep grinding. Honestly, I know Coach Brown says it, it's kind of cliche, but trust the climb, really. Like, you know, it's no limit on what you can do and where you can be. You just got to keep working.
All right, Coach, we appreciate it. Good luck with the draft. Looking forward to it. Thanks, Bryce. Nick?
Yeah, good stuff, Amanda. Looking forward to seeing what happens for Dante Stills and Bryce Ford Wheaton coming up very soon. NFL draft is next week. You saw a moment ago, pass intended for Preston Fox is incomplete on the 2-point conversion, so the score remains gold 53, blue 48 with 9:04 to go in the fourth quarter. And another new quarterback in there for the gold team. This is Scott Keene, the redshirt freshman from Weston, Florida, a product of St. Thomas Aquinas High School, his first action of the day.
You know, it's always fun to watch the young quarterbacks get some action because, again, as I mentioned, this is a true game day-like atmosphere, and it's a lot different than what you've gone through throughout the spring. You get the PA announcers, you get the lights, you get the band, you get the fanfare, you have everything, and you get to see how these guys react when the live rounds are firing. So this is going to be awesome work for them. They'll be able to go back and just kind of break down their reps and see how they play. That's it.
Keene's first pass is intended for Tyler Evans and falls incomplete. And now, Rasheed, you know, you mentioned this at the beginning of the broadcast. These are important moments here for these guys that maybe are second or third stringers right now, right on the offensive line or at wide receiver. This is their opportunity to really make an impression.
That's exactly right. Listen, this is a game, but you're still being evaluated. And for these younger guys, you have to remember, you want to make a lasting impression on these coaches going into fall camp to let them know that, listen, I have a future here. I belong here. Keep the upside high, and listen, you have a small opportunity of time, a small window to make plays, and you have to put something good on film.
Gene Townsell made the stop on the give to Colin McBee, the Morgantown native who went to University High School. Coach Brown said recently that McBee is a type of guy that they're going to find a way to use him. He could be a running back, maybe even line up at a fullback. In fact, fullback is probably his more natural position. Don't see too many fullbacks in college football these days, but you might see McBee a little bit. He redshirted last year for WVU. New QB again, it's Jake Robbins in there. Passes complete to Tyler Evans, but I think it was whistled dead in the backfield for a sack. Good pressure applied by the defensive line for the blue team. And remember, this is important. That was a third and 12. If it's a three and out, it's points for the blue team. If it's a first down, the drive extends for the gold team.
And it almost looks like they're winding the clock, moving a chain, so I don't think they ruled it down.
Okay, so there we go. Score is 53-48, 5-point game with under 7.5 to go in the fourth quarter. I think Rasheed's prediction is that it might be tied at the end of this one, and we go to sudden death.
I would like it. Listen, put these guys in a position to where they have to perform under pressure. And that's what Coach Brown, he likes to, you know, create these atmospheres where you have to be able to step up to the occasion and rise up and see what you're made of.
Robbins with the give to Jaheim White, breaking tackles and gaining 8 yards. White ripped off a big touchdown run a few moments ago. And some extended minutes here in the second half of the spring game for Jimmy Bell. We mentioned him earlier, the men's basketball forward who started in 43 games, who's 34 games last season, who's on a trial run with the football program.
You know, going back to what Wren said, if he's still working out with the basketball team,
remarkable.
That is impressive because I'm telling you, these guys work. They come in this building first thing in the morning, and they are here up until about 12:30, 1 o'clock for the guys who have class about noon, but that's pretty impressive.
Another new quarterback for the gold team. It's Jackson Crist. And a flag on the play. This is now the sixth different quarterback we've seen. Might be our first flag of the game, maybe in recent
Holding.
Memory.
Number 61 offense. 10-yard penalty, second down.
Well, right on cue, Jimmy Bell with the hold.
You hear the boos from the crowd. I think Jimmy Bell's created a fan base. They love him.
Averaged 4.8 points per game, 5.2 rebounds per game, and over 18 minutes per game last season on the hardwood. We'll see how this all pans out. Likely a decision coming soon about if Bell is going to stick with football or return to Bob Huggins' basketball team. Hoop squad making waves in the offseason as well. Transfer guard from Arizona, Kerr Kreisha, recently signed his letter of intent to join the Mountaineers for next season. Here's another give to Jaheim White. Look at the speed from White on the near side to pick up a first down and more inside the 35 to the 34.
Speed is absolutely right. So number 48, Gene Townsend, coming down from a safety position. He has the angle on Jaheim White. And you'll see right there, Jaheim just able to go into another gear and leave Gene behind. But, man, that's impressive. Again, Jaheim White, just a young freshman, I think his future is really bright if he can continue to learn, continue to grow, and continue to grind, just like Bryce said.
First and 10 from the 34. Give is to Colin McBee, and it's a short gain of about 2 for the gold team. Another new quarterback in there, by the way, for the gold team. It's Sam Stoner, number 19, true freshman, also from York, PA. The same hometown as Jaheim White. White attended William Penn High School. By the way, White is the leading rusher on the day. 5 attempts for 86 yards and a touchdown. That touchdown, his long run of the day, a 53-yarder.
Very impressive. We're seeing a lot of substitutions here. Coach Brown trying to get some guys a lot of reps. Wow, great break.
Terrific play by Eric Burton, the 6'5 redshirt freshman from Germany.
See, and that's what that position is all about. So as 6'5", he's a young player, but you want to be able to get into the passing lanes of the quarterback. So right there, he's able to use his long arms, get extended, and create deflections. There's one thing that coaches like. If you're able to create deflections and not be a catch type of tackle type of guy.
Scott Keen back behind center, almost intercepted by Jalen Shelton, the 6'2 safety from New London, Texas, and Tyler Junior College.
Yeah, a lot of good young talent. And he's another one. I know he's, you know, had some collegiate experience at junior college, but you know, still has two more seasons left here at WVU.
So the blue team is awarded 3 points for the defensive stop with 3:30 to go. So it's a 2-point game. Game very much still up for grabs for either team. A couple of weeks ago, Pro Day at WVU. Handful of players trying to make an impression on scouts from 28 NFL teams. Next season, the Big 12 will operate an exclusive Pro Day at the Ford Center at the Star in Frisco, Texas. It's a first-of-its-kind conference-wide Pro Day that will replace traditional on-campus Pro Days. It's an opportunity for even more exposure for pro prospects in the Big 12 to get up close and personal with NFL scouts. And there's more than just the scouting that's going to happen at that Pro Day. Goal not just to provide maximum exposure to scouts, but also to hiring officers from major corporations. There will be a job fair, non-football networking opportunities next year in Frisco, Texas. Any draft-eligible player in the conference will be able to participate in the Big 12's first conference-wide Pro Day next spring. Okay, to reset, 3.5 minutes to go in the fourth quarter, running clock here with the gold team leading 53-51. A three and out or a takeaway would give the blue team the lead. Another give to Jaheim White, who continues to rack up the yardage, and another stoppage by Eric Burton. By the way, with under 2 minutes to go, we will move to a normal clock where the clock will be stopped, sort of similar to the new NCAA rule. I'm sure you've heard about the rule change. Uh-oh, somebody just got doused with the Gatorade on the near sideline. Nick Malone is going after somebody and got him good. Rule change next year in college football. The clock will not stop after first downs, except for in the final 2 minutes of the first half and the second half. It's a major change to keep an eye on. White, the give again.
You know, one thing that I've noticed about Jaheim White, he doesn't go down on first contact. He's very small, compact, keeps the legs going, but I have not seen the first defender take him down on at that first point of attack.
By the way, just to clarify, Nick Malone and Big Jaquay Hubbard from Sharpsville, Pennsylvania, were in there to douse somebody with the Gatorade on the near sideline. Not sure who it was.
I think that was one of the managers. They call him Big Red.
Yeah, oh, okay.
That was Big Red is what he goes by.
2 minutes left, fourth quarter of the spring game. 53-51 your score with the gold team in front. Jake Robbins at quarterback sends one deep. And a great grab by C.J. Cole. who earlier today won the Tommy Nikolich Award as the program's most outstanding walk-on.
And he shows us why right there. He's had a great spring. Good adjustment to the ball right there. Not quite sure if that was meant to be an underthrown ball, but that's also one of the hardest balls for a defensive back to defend, especially if the receiver is able to make the adjustment, turn around and make that catch. It's almost impossible to defend as a defensive back. But great adjustment, great catch, and it's positive yardage.
Inside the final 90 seconds of the spring game, remember, a defensive stop here would be enough to give the blue team a victory. The give is to Colin McBee, shaking and breaking his way through close to that lead stick. It's going to be a gain of about 8, maybe 9 for the gold team.
Colin McBee runs hard. I wouldn't want to be one of those defensive backs coming downhill to have to stop him. I know I said CJ's the same exact way, but I've seen McBee up close, and he runs up that football pretty hard. He gets going north and south.
Tote for McBee again. Maybe got enough for the first down to the 22-yard line. Yes, indeed. Stopped by Donald Brandle.
All right. This looks like a setup for a walk-off field goal for the win, huh?
I think that's what we might be going for, right? Because if the defense gets a stop, that's 3 points. Got to make the field goal to get the win. Final minute of the spring game. By the way, McBee, 6'2", 232. Donaldson, 6'1", 239. Definitely have similar builds. It's a give to McBee again, and he's bottled up by a bunch of blue team tacklers. 31 different tacklers, 6 different passers, 10 different rushers, and 12 different receivers. So make that at least 60 players with a statistic recorded during the spring game. Clock winding down here, 11 seconds, 10 seconds to go. Rasheed Marshall, let's get your final thoughts. What did you think about today's game?
I thought it was great. I thought it was some good things that these guys are going to be able to continue to review and get better at. I thought it gave the coaches...
Timeout. Goal. This is their final of the game. 30-second timeout.
There were some things that the coaches are going to be able to continue to evaluate. But for these players, it's all about continuing to get better and using some momentum going into the fall camp.
All right, so let's recap our schedule of events for today. We had a bunch of one-on-one competitions as well as some live football. And one of the key things about the end of this game is that if the game was tied, Neil Brown gets the coach's call, perhaps a 2-point scenario to win the spring game for either team. It's not technically tied, gold team leading 53-51, but you never know what Coach Brown would have up his sleeves this late in the spring game. Wants to foster competition and wants to put pressure on players because he thinks that's the best way to really evaluate what they're going to act like in a game situation.
Listen, I was going to make this call. This is the perfect situation, as we talked about, putting players in situations where they have to step up to the plate. These kickers are going to feel an immense amount of pressure during the fall when they have to line up and nail a kick to win the game. What better way to send these guys off with this type of pressure and see if they can step up to the plate to make this kick?
All right, game on the line here for the redshirt junior, Danny King. And as if it were a real game, they're going to ice him. The blue team's going to ice him.
Blue, this is their final timeout of the half, 30 seconds in length.
So the ball on the 24-yard line, this is going to be about a 41-yard field goal for Danny King, the redshirt junior from Cumberland, Maryland. He appeared in the game against Towson last season, didn't kick a field goal, but had 4 kickoffs for 195 yards and a touchback. With the gold team leading by 2, this could give his squad the victory. Time for King to make a 42-yarder under pressure. Kick is up, and it's in there. And so that should be the final tally on the day at the Gold Blue Spring Game. Gold 56, Blue 51.
Listen, if I had to guess, I was going to say you send these guys off, you set it up to where you can get your kicker out on the field, put him under some pressure, because again, as Coach Brown said, he wants to see these guys that can continue to compete, put them under some high pressure situations, and what better way right there to send your guys off let your kicker line up, try to bang one through, and he knocked it through. Good job, Danny.
Hey, it wasn't that long ago that Casey Legg needed to kick a walk-off field goal against Oklahoma for that historic win for the old Golden Blue right here at Milan Puskar Stadium. A great day of action and competition, and as is tradition, we'll send you off with Country Roads here at Milan Puskar Stadium.
Going on down here. All right, Coach Brown, spring practice is officially over from start to finish. Did you get out of it what you wanted to this year?
Well, I hope so. You know, I really like coaching this group. It's a fun group to coach. You saw some good energy here today. It was entertaining football. It was pretty clean. And we had Big 12 officiating crew, and I thought it was clean. We're better on defense. It may have not shown today because we held some guys out. But I think we're covering the pass better, which was critical. And then on offense, we're really running the ball. And I feel like if we can just take care of the football, which we did today, and we can run the football, we're going to have a chance against everybody we play.
Who really stood out to you in this game today?
Well, let's talk second half. It was really good to see Devin Carter make a big play. And I thought our DBs really defended the deep ball well. Montre Miller made a couple nice plays down the field, which is a positive. And I thought we tackled. I thought our safeties, Aubrey Burks, came in and made a couple nice plays down by the line of scrimmage. And I thought our linebackers triggered and really were physical in the run game.
You told us this week that you had 6 goals for this spring, and you told these guys, and the last one, goal number 6, was find a way. You guys have to produce. Do you feel like your team did this today?
Well, I think so. It was fun. You know, anytime you're going offense, defense, you're kind of walking the fine line, because every time the offense has a positive play, that means the defense has a negative play. But I thought our better players were productive today, that's what I wanted our fans to see, is I thought both quarterbacks did some positive things. They have some areas we got to continue to improve, but they did some positive things. And I thought defensively, our leaders, Lee Koba, probably had 2 sacks on the day. Aubrey Burks tackled in space. You know, and I think some of the big guys, Hammond Russell, Mike Lockhart, did some nice things as well.
All right, Coach, appreciate it. Go enjoy this, and we'll see you in the fall.
Yeah, thanks, man.
All right, thanks, Nick.
All right, Amanda, and thank you very much, Coach Brown. So Nick Farrell here with Rasheed Marshall to put a bow on the Gold Blue spring game. Rasheed, your reaction to Coach Brown's comments?
Yeah, I think he hit the nail on the head, honestly, and it's nothing different than what we've been saying up here. I think every single one of these guys are going to be able to take away something that they can improve on heading into the summer and fall camp. There's a lot of momentum that's going to be taken from this game moving forward. But again, just a lot of work that needs to continue to happen to collectively get better.
Top performer today. Putting you on the spot.
Yes, you are. Oh, man. Do I have 3 choices?
Go ahead.
All right. I'm going to go Cortez. I'm going to go Garrett. And I have to give you a defensive guy. I'm going to go, oh, man, this is tough, Nick. Lee Koba, 2 sacks. You know, you can't leave him out of the mix. I thought the defensive line collectively did a good job. So I'll go with those top two and leave three open for the whole unit.
Got to give a shout out to Danny King, too, for the kick at the end under pressure, and Jaheim White making a big 53-yard touchdown run as well. Looking forward to seeing maybe a little bit more from the true freshman running back moving forward. All right, that'll do it for today's broadcast on Big 12 Now on ESPN+. Chuck Scatterday produced it. Eva Buckman directed it. For Rasheed Marshall, Amanda Mazey, and all the other members of our crew, I'm Nick Farrell saying so long from Mylan Pushkar Stadium, where the gold team defeated the blue team 56-51. All games airing on the ESPN networks are streaming live and archived on the ESPN app. This has been a presentation of ESPN.